Hey everybody, how's it going? Rose Griffin here from ABA Speech. Hope you're having a great Tuesday. I just wanted to pop on for our Facebook Lives. Every Tuesday at 9 p.m. Eastern, I'll be discussing different topics, little bits of information that will help you understand more about applied behavior analysis and be able to help your students expand their communication step by step. So just a couple things. If you are new here, I have a website, www.abaspeech.org. Make sure to, if you're not already, signed up for my email newsletter, that you go ahead and do that, because every month, towards the end of the month, I will be doing a freebie. So the freebie for September will be a webinar about collaborative services for students with autism and other complex communication needs. So tonight, what we're going to talk about are a little bit of an intro into the verbal behavior approach, what that means exactly. And we are going to talk about what some of the different verbal operants are. So if you're a speech-language pathologist, you know that we learned about a lot of different theories as far as how do we learn language. And we did learn about B.F. Skinner's approach to learning language, but it's not always something that all speech-language pathologists use in their sessions to help students increase their communication skills. So as I learn more about the verbal behavior approach, that is the approach that I use with my students when I am helping them expand their communication. So what I thought we'd do tonight is talk a little bit about that. B.F. Skinner in 1957 wrote a book called Verbal Behavior. And in that book, he talks about language and how language is learned. And he says that language is learned is a learned behavior, and it's reinforced through the mediation of other persons. So we talk a lot about speaker, listener roles. And if you're just tuning in, we're talking about the verbal behavior approach. So B.F. Skinner wrote that book. And so we talk about speaker, listener. I think sometimes as speech language pathologists, we're thinking about language as MLU. How do we increase a student's mean length of utterance? What Skinner did is he talks a little bit more about the function. How is language functioning? And so that gets to the different verbal operants. He had a unit of analysis called a verbal operant. And so sometimes as a speech language pathologist, you may be hearing these different terms when you're in a meeting, and even though it's something that you know what you're talking about, somebody in the behavior analytic world may be calling it something different. So I thought tonight we would just go over what those different verbal operants are. So one verbal operant that he identified was amand. Amand, the antecedent behavior before is motivation. A student is motivated to request something. So I have this book, The Pout Pout Fish. And if I wanted to request that or mand for it, depending on how I am communicating, I could be a verbal communicator, I could be communicating with an iPad, I could be communicating with a picture communication system. However you are communicating, you may say book, read book, I want the book, however, whatever your language level is. So if you want the item, you're motivated for it. In the behavior analytic world, we say you have an MO for it, and you request it, we would say that the student manded for book. So that would be an example. And the idea is that we want to make sure that students can request something, label it, answer a question about it, say it if they're verbal learners. And so that would be an example of manding. We will talk a lot about manding in subsequent Facebook Lives, because manding is really where you want to start when you're working with an early learner. Manding is so very important to helping students understand, I do something, I get something. I do something, I get something. So we will be talking a lot about manding. Another verbal operant that Skinner talked about was tacting. So tacting, the MO or what happens before, is a nonverbal stimulus. So this book would be considered a nonverbal stimulus. So if I have the book out, the book, and the learner sees it and they point to it and say, book, That would be their behaviors, verbal response, or they could label it with their device or give you a picture. They could sign book. And if they do that, when presented with something that's a nonverbal stimulus, that would be called a tact. Okay. Sometimes speech therapists would just call that a label, but if you're in the behavior analytic world or you're using a verbal behavior approach, and that's what I'll be talking about in subsequent Facebook Lives, because that's really how I teach my learners how to expand their communication. And that would be considered a tact, which is something that we'll talk about more in depth when we talk about tacting, because we'll eventually do a whole Facebook Live on tacting. And hopefully for some of you, that would be interesting. For others of you, it might be a snore fest, so maybe not turn in that sign. But anyway, so the idea is that we don't always, if we have a student and they're working on labeling or they're working on tacting, is that we don't always have to say, what is it? What is that? The idea is the mere presentation of something, they would label it. Or if you're at the zoo, let's say that this would be the perfect generalization. Let's say that you were working on labeling zoo animals, and in a session, a speech therapy session or a structured session, and then you go out to the zoo for a field trip. That would be an example. If the student sees a zebra or student sees a giraffe and they say, zebra, giraffe, that would be tacting. Okay, they would be tacting what they saw. It gets a little more complicated based on what there was motivation. If they wanted you to look at it, it might be a request. You know, look, zebra, that would be a mand. If they just saw it and they labeled it, that would be a tact. Okay? It can be very complicated, but I'm trying to make things simplistic, because the idea is just, how do I use this approach in my daily work working with students with autism, and how can I give you these little nuggets of information to, over the school year, feel more comfortable with these different terms and how I use them and how you can use them in your therapy sessions? Because it's very hard if you're a parent or a special educator or a speech language pathologist. It's hard to adopt something new, to use new strategies. It's one thing to listen to it. It's another thing to try it and take action on the information that you're being given. But I hope that's what you'll do this year, is take action and try something new if you're not already doing it. So an echoic is someone's verbal behavior is the antecedent, and the behavior is a matching, okay, matching verbal message. So if I said, say book, and the student says book, okay, that would be working on an echoic. So those of you who may use the Nancy Kaufman protocol, give me a like or a thumbs up if you are using that approach. So a lot of those, you know, apple, okay, help me, oh no, those are some that I just make up on my own. Oat, I, up. Those are saying that we're working on echoic. So I say it, you say it, and our verbal message is exactly the same. So that would be an echoic. And so some students may be working on echoics using, maybe they're using sign and pictures and a total communication system. Or maybe they're just starting to verbally imitate, and so that you're working on that more directly, and that's going to be their main form of communication. Okay, so that would be an echoic. An intraverbal, the antecedent is that they have someone's verbal behavior. The behavior of the other person is that the message is not matching. Okay, so an example of this, it could be a fill-in, it could be answering a question, and the point that's important to remember is that it doesn't match. So we could do fill-in. So I could say, and I did this today in therapy, I could say, I read a book. So when the student says book, that would be an intraverbal. That's filling in the blank. Okay. If I asked a student, what's your favorite book? And they said, The Pout Pout Fish. Okay. That would be also an intraverbal. I asked them something, they said something back, and our answers didn't match. Okay. Our verbal language didn't match. And so that means that it's an intraverbal. And intraverbals are so very important. I think they get overlooked sometimes, because sometimes the standardized speech therapy tests that we give do not always look at requesting, do not always look at intraverbal. Some of them might, not so much manding, but some of them might look at those other things, but they don't always break it down into those different verbal operants. So we're going to be talking about an assessment. If you're listening live or you're watching the rebroadcast, we're going to be talking an assessment called the VB map. And so if you use that assessment, let me know. I have a free webinar about that assessment, an intro to that assessment on www.abaspeech.org. And Dr. Mark Sundberg created that assessment, and I love that assessment. I've been using it for 7 or 8 years, and it gives you a really good idea of what is a scope and sequence when you're working with somebody who is having trouble manding, is having trouble tacting, and how do I set up an intervention program that is really gonna help that student, okay? So if you're just tuning in now, we just talked about what is a mand, what is a tact, what is an echoic, and what is an intraverbal. So those were the main verbal operants that B.F. Skinner discussed. He discussed others, and I hope that I described them in a way that made them seem simple, but a way that was true to his definition. And so I wanted to talk about that because that's how I teach my students with autism and other complex communication disorders how to expand their communication. And so that's why I started this whole ABA speech, was to help people who are working with students with autism and other complex communication disorders expand their students' language step by step. It is a step-by-step process. There is no magic wand, unfortunately. I know a lot of people wish there was, but it is a very powerful science. And so that's what we're going to be talking about this year. And that is the bulk of what we were going to talk about today. The other thing that I wanted to talk to you about, if you are a speech language pathologist, I had an article that was published in the ASHA Leader. And so this article is about, it says, it can be fun and games. It's on page 36, and it's about modified leisure skills for students with autism and other complex communication disorders. And it's for students who are older. So I talk about, how do I assess leisure skills? Why are leisure skills so important? They're so important because across the lifespan, leisure skills are so important. When I'm done with work, I like to relax, right? I like to watch Netflix. Well, I have 3 kids, so I hang out with my kids. But I like to do things after work. That's important to me. And so I know that we all have leisure skills, and sometimes it's hard because our students, if they're not directly taught leisure skills, and if the leisure skills aren't modified, it's really hard for them to engage in them. So in this article, I talk about how to modify Uno, how to modify Scrabble, how to modify Yahtzee, and then I also talk about a game called the grocery store game. And those are all on my webinar website as well. So www.abaspeech.org. I have free modified leisure videos that I've made that you can use as video models. Tomorrow I'm gonna do a group, and I'm gonna do Uno, and I'm gonna use those videos as a video model. So I will show it to the students before we play the game. And another thing that I wanted to tell you about, if you are on Teachers Paid Teachers, I have a free resource that I just put up that is Getting to Know You. And so it's questions, you roll the dice, and then you ask a question that correlates with the number on the dice that you rolled. And so hopefully you can check that out. My Teachers Paid Teachers is ABA Speech. I also wanted to let you know that I have the Action Builder cards for sale. I created this product called the Action Builder cards. There's 100 high resolution photos that help you teach your learners how to generalize, labeling actions and nouns and putting sentences together. So it plans for generalization. It shows, instead of showing one picture of eating, it shows many pictures of boys and girls eating so that we can plan for generalization. We're taking what's going on in the therapy room and we're transferring it to what's happening out and about. So that's so very important. Join me next week, because next week we're going to talk about pairing. What is pairing? That's another good ABA type term, and we're going to talk about what does pairing mean. We're going to talk about a little bit more of terminology, and we'll talk about what a preference assessment is. So if you've ever worked with a student who doesn't like anything, who seems like they don't even like to watch the iPad, I have had students like that, and so you need to know where to start with a student like that. So if you have students who have challenging behavior, who are limited verbally, who are struggling to find a way to communicate, tune in next week, Tuesday, 9 p.m., and we will talk about pairing, we will talk about what a preference assessment is, and we will talk about how is that really going to be the building blocks to helping a student develop a functional response form. So as always, if you have any friends or other professionals who are working with students with autism, sharing is caring. Let them know about ABA Speech. I also have a YouTube over at ABA Speech. Pop on my website, www.abaspeech.org. Sign up for my newsletter, because every month we're going to have freebies this school year. And this school year's freebie this month is going to be a webinar about collaboration. So how do we collaborate with other professionals? I'm also on Instagram, ABA Speech by Rose. And I hope that you will check that out. So have a great week, and I'll see you soon. Bye.